We totally take pencils for granted. This writing right here, it only works because of a unique chemical phenomenon happening inside the pencil lead. And that phenomenon could hold the key to the future of electronics, medicine, space travel, energy storage, and more. But only if we can actually get past the hype and harness it appropriately. The graphite in pencil lead, which you probably know isn't actually elemental lead at all, is just the right chemical structure to leave some of itself behind as a mark on the paper. Graphite is composed of layers of carbon. Within each individual layer, each carbon atom is tightly bound to three other carbon atoms in a honeycomb pattern. Each layer is a single sheet of graphene, and there are only very weak van der Waals interactions between the layers. This means they can easily slide relative to one another due to those weak interactions, so as you run the pencil tip across paper, layers of graphene are left behind. And you might know that graphite isn't the only carbon structure that we commonly find uses for. Diamonds are also composed of pure carbon atoms, but in a different pattern that looks like this. This 3D carbon structure is way stronger than graphite in all directions, with each carbon equally strongly bonded to four other carbons in a tetrahedral structure. Running a diamond across paper isn't going to leave little chunks of diamond behind, thankfully. In fact, diamond is the strongest substance known and is often used in really intense drill bits. But writing and drilling aren't the only things we're trying to use unique carbon structures for. For decades, scientists have wondered if we could make new carbon structures or configurations that could be used in everything from building better superconductors to really precise drug delivery to brain-computer interfaces. But it's been decades. We were promised graphene batteries and Buckyball-based medicines by now. In fact, a 1991 Popular Science article teased that carbon structures called Buckyballs could bring us lightweight batteries, powerful rocket fuels, and infinite possibilities of plastics. Put those three things together and you know what you get? A jetpack. Where's my jetpack? So how close are we actually to tiny carbon structures running our world? I am tired of driving. I would like my eco-friendly jetpack now, please. So if you're familiar with any weird carbon structure, it's probably the Buckyball. First described in 1985, Buckyballs, or Buckminster fullerene, are clusters of 60 carbon atoms shaped like a soccer ball, with 12 pentagonal faces and 20 hexagonal faces. The scientists who first created them were interested in learning about how carbon chains formed in space. So to try and replicate some of those interstellar conditions, they vaporized graphite with lasers and then allowed it to quickly cool in a stream of helium. You know, as you do when you're looking for carbon space dust. When the carbon dust cleared, what was left behind were little carbon clusters, or buckyballs. Also, a side tangent here, that the last paragraph of the paper that described this is an absolute eye roll. They named the compound after Buckminster Fuller, an architect who designed a lot of geodesic domes. But then in their own paper, they say, "We are disturbed at the number of letters and syllables in the rather fanciful but highly appropriate name." And they suggest other names, like ballene, sphereene, soccerene, or carbo-soccer, which are all terrible. In the end, they say they prefer to let this issue of nomenclature be settled by consensus, and apparently we, the consensus, settled on buckyballs. The scientists speculated that buckyballs formed under the violent conditions found in space, things like UV radiation, harsh vacuums, and super cold temperatures, might be plentiful out in the universe. They also thought that these buckyballs could help play a role in explaining how early life formed in the early Earth. Because, you know, space conditions, early Earth, chemistry. And a few things about buckyballs made the scientific community interested in their useful potential. Like amazing batteries, or jetpacks. First, buckyballs are a relatively simple structure, and they're hollow. Early studies showed that scientists could place other molecules into those hollow cores, which might make them useful for storing or delivering things like medicine. They're also made up of just one common element, carbon, which can make creating them easier than more complex compounds. Scientists had a number of ideas of how they might be useful in everything from lubricants to rocket fuel and superconductors to even at one point an anti-HIV drug. Buckyballs were 1991's Molecule of the Year, with Science magazine proclaiming that the new structure unleashes tantalizing new experimental and theoretical ideas. and that improving life through science is a path that would see all citizens of the world holding hands like the carbon atoms in C60, and like them, welcoming any newcomer, no matter how different his or her skills or challenges.
Money is the real thing. What the world wants today.
They were really excited about Buckyballs. The 90s were weird. But the actual applications of Buckyballs and similar spherical compounds have been slow to materialize. There's lots of really fascinating research into their potential applications. Coatings containing Buckyballs have been proposed as machine lubricants, and other spherical carbon structures with slightly different numbers of carbons have been tried as drug delivery vehicles. But most of these applications are still in the development stage, decades later. We've been almost there for a long time now. But research on Buckyballs led to another potentially useful carbon structure, carbon nanotubes. So if you imagine taking a sheet of graphene and folding it up into a cylinder, you would get a carbon nanotube. It's a nanotube because it's like it's a tiny tube. This is not to scale. To make a nanotube, scientists coat a silicon wafer in metal catalysts like iron or nickel. They put them into a furnace with carbon-containing gases. Rings of carbon start to form on the catalyst, determining the diameter of the tube. As more and more carbons are added, the tube grows longer and longer, and the catalyst particles rise up off the wafer. They'll keep on growing until the catalyst particle is covered in carbon and deactivated. Carbon nanotubes are typically about 1 nanometer in diameter, 80 to 100,000 times thinner than a human hair. Discovered in the early 90s, they too were thought to hold a lot of scientific promise. Nanotubes are tiny hollow wires made up of only carbon, with every atom on the surface of the tube. They have a really high tensile strength, meaning they can resist being broken when stretched, as well as a high elasticity, meaning they'll easily return to their original shape if bent or stretched. They also have some pretty cool electronic properties. Carbon nanotubes can act either as conductors or semiconductors, materials with properties between those of insulators and conductors. Fascinatingly, that depends on the chirality of the nanotube, whether the hexagons are oriented this way or if they were oriented in the opposite direction. Semiconductors are incredibly useful in tiny computer chips, which are in everything from watches to phones to cars to computers. Carbon nanotube semiconductors might be helpful in building tiny electronics and mechanics that are faster and require less power than the silicon semiconductors we use today. But producing, aligning, and building computer chips with these tiny tubes can be difficult. They need to be perfectly aligned, like bundles of dry spaghetti, which is incredibly hard to do when you think about the fact you're working with something only 1 nanometer wide. Despite this, carbon nanotubes are actually used in some products today. In fact, several thousand tons of them are made and sold each year. Some are used in water filtration products, while others are used as electrodes in batteries and capacitors. And they can be made into strong frames for things like bikes and tennis rackets. If you know anyone who rides a fancy bike, they've absolutely told you about their carbon fiber bike frame. You know they have. Are you that person? Unfortunately, like Buckyballs, nanotubes are still most often talked about for the applications that they could have rather than what they are doing right now. They're useful, but they're not yet powering my phone or my watch or my jetpack. Now, if we want to look at the next big potential carbon innovation, we actually have to go back to the graphene sheets from our pencils. There are lots of groups working on making single layer sheets of graphene, and while it was first successfully accomplished in 2004, it's taken a bit for the production to get to a stage where we can do it efficiently enough for graphene to make a potentially useful product. The current best strategy of making graphene sheets is to use something called chemical vapor deposition. Like the nanotubes, it involves a thin substrate layer coated in some kind of catalyst inserted into a furnace. A carrier gas, like methane, is added to the furnace as well. The high heat decomposes the methane into carbon, and the carbon deposits onto the catalyst layer. With just the right conditions, you can get a single atomic layer of graphene. Or, believe it or not, you can make small quantities of it using tape as well. If I put this piece of graphite right in the middle of this tape, press it together, and then pull it apart, I've pulled a few layers of graphene off of that big original chunk. And now I can do that again and again and again to get down to thinner and thinner sheets. Scientists discovered this method of making graphite sheets in 2004, and in 2014, another group found that you could actually do this using the shear forces in a big mixer to exfoliate layers of graphene off of graphite. You can even do this in your own home blender. But I refuse because I love my morning smoothies and I will not sacrifice my blender for this. Like nanotubes, there are also a lot of people interested in using graphene for its electrical properties. Electrons can really quickly travel through the orbital shells of the carbon atoms in graphene, making it a great conductor. In fact, one of the best conductors. Electrons can zip through these graphene sheets faster than any other known material at room temperature. We can actually demonstrate this conductivity with just a pencil and some paper. If I take this multimeter, I can actually measure how well electrons flow through a square of graphite drawn on the graph paper. What we're measuring here is the resistance that electrons feel as they pass through the graphite, and it's very low. There are a few big areas where graphene could actually be useful, and one is renewable energy, where scientists hope to use graphene in batteries, fuel cells, and other energy storage methods. Its flexibility and thinness and great conductivity have a lot of groups hoping that it could replace silicon in all kinds of electronics. There's also a lot of work looking at using graphene in biomedical applications, things like embedded sensors under the skin to track blood sugar or heart rate, or biointerfacing in the brain, allowing people with diseases that leave them unable to control their muscles the ability to communicate with the outside world. And other groups are already using it to make conductive ink or filtration and separation membranes, or fancy new displays and screens to make our everyday lives better. There is, however, a problem with graphene. If you're flowing electrons through it, it's really hard to get them to stop flowing through it. You need something called a band gap to turn the flow of electricity off, and this has been really hard to engineer into graphene. But a couple of groups have figured out a way to do this by using not one sheet of graphene, but two, putting them together and twisting them. If you take two sheets of graphene and then stack them and then twist them super slightly, just 1.1 degrees, you can turn the graphene sandwich from a conductor, which allows electrons to easily flow from one atom to the next, into an insulator, which restricts the flow of electrons, and then into a superconductor, which is a conductor on metaphorical steroids, passing electrons along with basically no resistance. Now, they've labeled this field twistronics, and like, saccharine, twistronics, come on, chemists, your naming is not great. When the two sheets of graphene are twisted at that incredibly very precise 1.1 degree angle, they form a moiré pattern. That is the pattern that forms when you shift two grids over one another, like this animation that I'm going to make the animator make. You get alternating spots of dark and light. The overlapping dark areas allow atoms to act together like super atoms, which is what allows the electrons to flow between them so quickly. It's like the electrons are moving around the same atom rather than having to hop between atoms. Unfortunately, to get this superconductivity, you have to chill the structures down almost all the way to absolute zero. Cold temperatures are pretty common for superconductors, but it means they're not actually going to be used in our phones or computer screens or anything anytime soon. And that is super frustrating, because if we could find a way to economically manufacture and chill these devices, they could be useful for things like quantum computing or for ultra-sensitive detectors. One group showed that they could detect a single photon of far infrared light with this stuff. A single photon. One photon. That is incredibly cool. And of course, scientists have continued to build these materials out, moving from bilayers of graphene to twisted trilayer graphene sandwiches, which show even more robust superconductivity. So this is the thing, then, that's going to make my jetpack real. This is it, right? Well, like buckyballs and nanotubes, a lot of this stuff is still just really new. Graphene is used in some phones as a heat dissipating layer, and the makers of some fancy audio equipment tout 5 to 10 layer sheets of graphene as strong yet flexible additions to diaphragms inside earbuds. Graphene is also used in wearable sensor prototypes, and its thinness means it could have applications in all kinds of wearable tech, as sensors, batteries, and conductors. It just feels like we are right on the cusp of the electronics on our wrists and in our pockets being full of graphene, but we're still not quite there yet. But this play bar has not hit the end yet. There are still weirder, potentially world-changing carbon structures out there that we can talk about. So let's do that. I would need way more pieces to make this next structure, so we're gonna have to go to an image. Scientists have recently made a single layer of buckyballs all bonded together that looks a little something like this. This material could be really interesting because it's made up of conductive graphene and insulating buckyballs, meaning it could be used as a semiconductor in some new electronic devices. But how do you actually make something like this? You can't just stick some buckyballs together with really teeny tiny tweezers. So first, the scientists made buckyballs, and then they heated the pre-made buckyballs up with magnesium powder. So the buckyballs all stuck to each other, and their negative charges repelled the magnesiums, creating interspersed sheets of buckyballs and magnesium. The researchers then swapped the magnesium ions out for a bulky ion, and then were able to peel the layers apart. Though, actually, the peeling was described as manual shaking in the article, which sounds way more fun. The result was single layers of honeycombed buckyballs that were described by one article as coming apart like layers of bubble wrap. So you can imagine that each one of these little bubbles is a buckyball all stuck together in a hexagonal pattern. And then once they had those bulky ions in there, they were able to just pull those layers apart and peel them off one by one, giving you a sheet of buckyballs. But like the structures before it, they're still investigating the properties of this new material, and they're not 100% sure what it'll be used for yet. This sounds pretty similar to basically everything we've talked about so far. It's a lot of potential, but not a lot of change in my world right now. So how close are we actually to a graphene and carbon structure powered future? How do we get out of this repeating pattern of excitement and then honestly disappointment? Well, one of the experts I talked to told me that this time, really, we are close. Electronic ink, conductive glues, and electromagnetic shielding using these structures are already happening. And the next big thing that companies are tackling are energy storage technologies using carbon structures, because we all know we need better ways to store energy right now. A recent McKinsey report is a little more sedate, suggesting that while graphene will help to enhance the current technology that we've already got over the next 5 to 10 years, it'll be probably 10 to 25 years before graphene replaces silicon in our devices, and 25 plus years before we get the promised technologies of the future. So maybe no jetpacks quite yet. But I'll take a better battery.